To be able to save our data, we'll of course need to have our save button. We'll start by creating a basic toolbar that will hold both the file name and the save button, that will be disabled or enabled depending if there is a name error or not in the graph. So to create our toolbar, let's set to our editor window script, and under our addGraphView method, we will call a new method we'll create named addToolbar. I'll add this method to our elementsAddition region under our addGraphView method. In here, we'll have to create a new toolbar and add elements into it. Thankfully, Unity already provides us with a toolbar class that we can use to create it, so type in toolbar and import its namespace. Then I'll name it toolbar and call its constructor. We now add this toolbar to the editor root visual element variable by typing in rootVisualElement.add and pass in our toolbar. We will want to add two things to this toolbar for now. The text field that will hold the graph name, which will also be the dialog's parent folder name, and the save button, that will call our save method later on. So let's create a new text field which I'll name FileNameTextField and use our dselementUtility class to create the text field. So type in dselementUtility.createTextField. And in here we'll want the default name for our graph. I'll create a private variable above for that of type string, and I'll name it defaultFileName. Give it any value you'd want. I'll give it the value of dialogsFileName. Because we won't be updating this value, we can make the variable be read-only. You could make it a constant or something else if you wanted to. I just made the one Visual Studio recommended me. We can now pass in this variable as our text field text. We also want to pass in a label so that the user knows this is a text field for the file name. So we'll have to go to our createTextField method and add a new parameter of type string, which I'll name label and default it to null. Then pass it in the object initializer. We shall do the same for our textIra method, so add the same parameter there and pass it into the createTextFill method. This will throw errors whenever we are calling these methods with a callback, so go there and make sure you pass in null for the label in each of the method calls. Back to our editor window addToolbar method, pass in as a label the text of FileName. All that's left is our save button, so create a new variable of type button, which I'll name save button, and create it using our element utility by typing in dselementUtility.createButton and pass in save as the text. We won't be setting the callback for now. All that's left is to add these elements to the toolbar, so type in toolbar.add and pass in our FileName text field. And do the same for our save button. We now have our toolbar added, so if we save and go back to Unity, we should be able to see our toolbar at the top. We shall now start by disabling our save button whenever we have an error in our graph, and enabling it again when there are no more errors left. We'll actually do that by using a property of type integer, but instead of doing an automatic property, we will do our own setter. What we'll do is quite simple. Every time a repeated name error happens, we will increment 1 to the value of the property. Every time a repeated name is no longer a repeated name, we will decrement 1 to the value of the property. Whenever the current value of the property is 0, we can enable our save button. Otherwise, whenever it is over 0, it means there are errors in our graph, so we should disable our save button. So back to our graph view, we'll actually have to create two variables because our property won't be automatic anymore. So we'll have to do it the normal way, which is create a private variable and then create a public one that gets and sets that private variable. So type in private int and I'll name it repeated names amount. Then create a new one by typing in public int, and I'll name it the same but with the first letter being uppercase. Once that's done, we'll need to set our property getOnSet. So type in get and between curly brackets type in return repeated names amount. For our set, type in set and between curly brackets we'll be setting our value and also update the state of our save button. Let's start by setting our value by typing in repeated names amount and set it to be value. This value is from the property and simply holds the new value that this property will have, which will either be -1 or +1 than its previous value in our case. Then we'll have an if statement to see if the value is now 0 or not. So type in if repeated names amount equals 0, and if that's true, we will want to enable our save button. So I'll type in a comment for now saying enable save button. Otherwise, we'll have to disable it. You can either do it when the value is 1 or every time it is not 0. I don't think it will have a big performance impact, but I'll type in a new if statement instead of else. So if repeated names amount equals 1 and type in a comment saying disable save button. Of course, feel free to do it as you desire. As unless you are creating every node right off the bat without updating their names, the else statement is likely to not happen a lot. We have our property, so we now need to create our methods that allow us to enable or disable the save button. We'll actually do that in our editor window, so let's head there. And let's start by making a global button variable to which I'll name save button. We can then remove the button type in our hatToolbar method. This variable is just so we can update the state of our save button in our yet to be created methods. So let's create the enable method by typing in public void enable saving, and I'll place this method inside of a variation named utility methods. Inside we'll simply have to enable the button, so type in save button dot set enabled and pass in true. For disabling, we'll of course be doing the opposite. We will need to pass in false. So copy the method above and swap the enable with disable instead. And then pass in false instead of true. Back to our graph view, we can now swap the comments with the correct methods. So swap the first comment with editorWindow.enableSaving. And then swap the second comment with editorWindow.disableSaving. We now need to update the value of our property. And we'll do that in all of our add and remove methods. In our add methods, whenever the count gets to 2, we should increment 1 to the property value, as that's when we know a new repeated name has occurred. In our remove methods, whenever the count gets to 1, we should decrement 1 to the property value, as that's when we know that name is no longer a repeated name. So let's go to our add and group node method, and in our last if check statement type in ++ repeated name amounts. This will add 1 to the repeated file name scene property whenever we had a new node and there was already one with the same name. Because this is in the if check statement, when the count is equal to 2, it will only happen once per name. Then, in our remove and group node method, we decrement 1 when our count gets to 1, as it means it was previously 2, but the second node with the same name was removed, so it shall no longer throw an error. So type in --- repeated name amounts. Do the same in all our other 4 methods. Saving and going back to Unity, our save button shall now enable or disable depending if there is an error or not in a graph. With that done, our basic toolbar functionality is done. But of course, its styles are not looking like the rest of our system. We will update their styles by creating a new stylesheet for our toolbar and then updating whatever we want there. So go to our editor default resources folder, and in our dialog system folder, create a new style sheet by right-clicking in the project window, going to Create, UI Toolkit, and choose Style Sheet. I'll name it DS Toolbar Styles. Thankfully for us, most of our styles are equal to what we have in our node, so we'll be able to get most of it from there. We will, however, have some slight differences, like whenever a label is focused, as I'll want to show it with a golden color. This will allow us to know our filename text will be selected and will make it seem a bit more important. The best option will be to have a style sheet that holds the styles that are equal so that we could simply reuse them between different elements. So if you want to do that, feel free to go ahead and do it. I'll just do it this way for no particular reason besides deciding early on that I will do one style sheet per type. We will start with our toolbar, so type in toolbar as the selector, and we'll be updating its background color and its height. So background color, and we already have the color I want to give it, so var and pass in ds colors window dark gray 1. For our height, we'll give it var ds matrix window pixels 35. This will make our toolbar darker and be taller. Then we'll update the text field and give it a padding of 4 pixels. So padding var ds matrix pixels 4. Next are our buttons. We can actually use the same styles as our nodes here, so let's go to our node styles and copy our buttons in all of the 3 states. We will update the selector to only be button. The reason why I'm not caring too much about classes here is because we'll be adding our style sheet to the toolbar itself, as there will be only one, which in our nodes case we added the whole style sheet to the graph view, which takes more than nodes. Next, let's update our label to also have a padding of 4 pixels. We'll be using an unity selector for this, so type in unity text field underscore underscore label and pass in padding var ds matrix window pixels 4. The next one will make it so that the label gets golden when we focus on the text field. So I'll type in text field for the focus pseudo class, greater than, and then the same selector as above. Then update the color to be var ds colors window yellow. Then we'll update the text field input, and we can use our node styles here, so copy them and paste it in our toolbar styles. Feel free to remove the initial node class selector. We will, however, update a few styles. Remove the max width and make it a max height instead, passing in 25 pixels. For the min width, pass in 120, in which we'll need to add an extra variable in our style variables. For our padding, we'll make it padding left and swap the pixels to be 6. We will also need to add an extra variable for this one. Then we'll want to update its color to yellow when it is focused, so type in the same class selector but with the focus pseudo class, and then type in color var ds colors window yellow. Feel free to remove this one if you don't want the text field input text to be yellow when it is selected. The styles are done, so all that's left is to add a style sheet to our toolbar. Let's head back to our editor window script, and in our add toolbar method type in at the end, just above our root visual element line, toolbar.addStyleSheets, and pass in the path dialog system at dstoolbarstyles.uss. Saving and going back to Unity, our toolbar shall now have our styles.